The Senator from Texas.
Mr. President, today the Senate Judiciary Committee held a vote on William Barr to be the next Attorney General of the United States. During his confirmation hearing a few weeks ago, we saw an articulate, measured, and highly capable individual, and there's no question in my mind why two separate presidents have selected him to lead the Department of Justice. Throughout his impressive career, Mr. Barr displayed both the legal acumen and the unwavering commitment to the rule of law, a basic prerequisite to serve as the highest law enforcement officer in the country. I would add that the Attorney General is a unique member of the cabinet because he is, as I said, the chief law enforcement officer of the country, but he's also a political appointee of the president. So it takes some skill to navigate that very thin line and to do it with distinction and honor, something that Mr. Barr has done before. President George Herbert Walker Bush recognized the talent in Mr. Barr more than 25 years ago and nominated him for not one, not two, but three important roles in the Department of Justice. Mr. Barr testified before the Judiciary Committee for each of these positions: Assistant Attorney General for the Office of Legal Counsel, Deputy Attorney General, and finally, Attorney General of the United States. All three times, he was unanimously approved by the Senate. As impressive as Mr. Barr was during these confirmation hearings, he was even more impressive once he was actually on the job, and it's clear he made a lasting impression on his colleagues at the Department of Justice. A group of 120 former Justice Department and law enforcement officials have written a letter to the chairman and ranking member of the Judiciary Committee supporting Mr. Barr's nomination. The list includes former attorneys general and deputies attorneys general, FBI directors and deputy directors, a Department of Homeland Security secretary, and a host of high-ranking DOJ officials. They wrote, and I quote, "Bill is that rare combination of intellect and principle who has served our country in the Department of Justice with great distinction and then excelled as a senior executive in the private sector." They continued, "Bill also developed great partnerships with state and local law enforcement departments around the country through the department's executive working group, creating joint task forces to combat white-collar crime, drug trafficking, and violent crime across the nation." Knowing that, it's no surprise he received the endorsement of several organizations that represent law enforcement, like the International Association of Chiefs of Police, the Major City Chiefs Association, the Fraternal Order of Police, the Major County Sheriffs of America, and the National Narcotic Officers Association Coalition, and as well as others. To quote our friend, the ranking member, Dianne Feinstein herself, she said, "No one can say he's not qualified." We're fortunate to have such an individual who's willing to once again step back into the spotlight to serve his country. To me, that speaks volumes. It would be the easiest thing in the world for Mr. Barr to say, "Well, I've been there, done that. Now I've worked in the private sector, been a success, and I'm ready to hang it up or at least enjoy my retirement years with my grandkids and my wife." Not Bill Barr. Bill Barr is a person driven by his sense of duty, his desire to serve the American people, and to me, that's one of the distinctions about him that impresses me the most. It'd be easy for him to take a walk and to not accept this responsibility during these polarized times, but he's willing to serve, and I think we ought to embrace that willingness to serve and confirm him. I was proud to support Mr. Barr's nomination in the Judiciary Committee today, and I look forward to voting yes on his nomination next week when we vote on it. Although Mr. Barr's name has been in the headlines, there are also a number of well-qualified nominees for federal judgeships across the United States who were reported out of the Judiciary Committee today, including four Texans. They are J. Campbell Barker and Michael Troncalli to be United States District Judges for the Eastern District of Texas, Matthew Kaczmarek to be United States District Judge for the Northern District of Texas, and David Morales to be the United States District Judge for the Southern District of Texas. These individuals are principled and highly qualified for the federal bench. Senator Cruz and I work closely with our Federal Judicial Evaluation Committee, a bipartisan committee of the best lawyers in the state of Texas, to screen these individuals and then make recommendations to the White House. So I'm confident in their ability to serve Texans by faithfully applying the law, and I hope the Senate will move quickly to confirm them. Mr. President, finally, following the President's call for unity and bipartisanship in his State of the Union address earlier this week, I'm glad to see the Senate responding to that call and taking up legislation that we're currently on that has received broad bipartisan support in the Senate just today. Near the end of the last Congress, the Senate and the House reached an agreement on a package of more than 100 individual lands bills that received broad bipartisan support. Unfortunately, we ran out of time and weren't able to get it done. But next week, we'll have the opportunity to vote on this important piece of legislation and send this bipartisan bill to the President's desk, and to demonstrate once again to the American people, lest anybody be in doubt, that we are capable of working together in a bipartisan way and advancing the interests of the American people. Throughout my time in the Senate, I've been an advocate for America's outdoor sporting traditions and common sense wildlife conservation policies. Enhancing and expanding sportsmen's access to federal lands has been on Congress's to-do list for years, and this legislation will help make that a reality. This package includes a series of bipartisan provisions negotiated over years, which will provide increased opportunities for sportsmen and sportswomen to utilize federal lands for hunting and fishing. Those changes are coupled with additional ones for conserving and enhancing wildlife habitats to ensure we're protecting these lands for generations to come. This legislation also authorizes dozens of land swaps, exchanges, and conveyances, which will deliver big changes to communities across the country, including my state. For example, the Lake Fannin Recreation Area was once a thriving tourist attraction for Texas, but through the years, it's become dilapidated due to the inability of the Forest Service to properly do maintenance. The county has developed now a comprehensive plan to manage that land for recreation, and this bill will restore local control to more than 2,000 acres in Fannin County, Texas. This legislation will also protect property owners along the Red River, the border between Texas and Oklahoma, who have faced uncertainty following a flawed Bureau of Land Management survey under the previous administration. This legislation will ensure that the federal government will make no claim and has no rightful claim to their property. Again, I look forward to debating this legislation in the coming days, and I hope we can pass this bill, which will allow for the responsible development and conservation of land across our country. Seeking the floor, so I would note the absence of a quorum. I will withhold that based on the signals I received from the presiding officer.